I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. And I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. And he gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Savior and I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. And he keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and over again. My God keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over and over again. And he gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Savior and I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again.
The scripture reading this morning would be taken from Luke chapter 7, verses 34 through 46. That's Luke chapter 7. Verses 34 through 46. And it reads, "The Son of Man is come eating and drinking, and ye say, behold a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of all her children. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the anointment. Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And then they had nothing to pay. He frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them would love him most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I enter into thy house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman have anointed my feet with ointment. Amen. Let us go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, and ask you at this time to forgive us for any sins that may hinder this prayer in deed or thought. We thank you, Lord God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, Lord God. We ask you at this time, Lord God, just to be with this worship service this morning, Lord God. Bless us, Lord God, as we go through the worship service, Lord God. Bless us to do everything decent and orderly, Lord God. Also, Lord God, just be with the world at this time, Lord God. You know what's going on in the world, Lord God, with the virus and everything, Lord God. Be with all the ones that are at home, Lord God. You know who they are, Lord God. Be with them, Lord God. Strengthen us, Lord God. Be with all of your children, Lord God, in the faith. And you know who they are, Lord God. Just bless all of us at this time, Lord God. Knowing, Lord God, that we can't do nothing but praise you, Lord God, and come to you. Because we know, Lord God, that it's all about you at this time, Lord God, and all the time. So we ask you at this time, Lord God, just give us that peace that passeth our understanding, Lord God. Protect us, guide us, and just be with all the ones that are sick in the household of faith, Lord God. Strengthen them at this time, Lord God. Be with the ones that got the virus, Lord God. You know who they are. If it's any in the faith, Lord God, or out of the faith, bless them and strengthen their families at this time, Lord God. We ask you at this time, be with all the ones that lost loved ones. Strengthen their bodies, strengthen their families at this time, and just protect and guide them, Lord God. Also, Lord God, at this time, we ask you to be with all the ones that strayed away. You know who they are, Lord God. Bring them back to the fold, Lord God. We just pray, Lord God, that you just give them that grace and mercy. We ask you also, Lord God, at this time to be with the Speaker of the Hour, Brother Middlebrook, Lord God. We thank you for him. Be with him. Be with his wife. Bless him today, Lord God, as he preach your word, Lord God. And that he would say something that would prick someone's heart to say, what must I do to be saved? We love you, Lord God, and we thank you, Lord God. And we just ask you, be with the world at this time, Lord God. We all are going through something, Lord God, and we all are dealing with this virus at this time, Lord God. So we just ask you, Lord God, to deal with us, Lord God. Give us that peace. Give us everything that we need, the joy, the love, and just to say something about Jesus, no matter what's going on in our life, that we can talk about your son, Jesus. We love you and we thank you. This we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all say amen and thank God for all of his goodness, for his grace and his continuous mercy upon us. We're grateful this morning to be here and to be a part of this worship service that God has allowed. We realize that there is much going on in our world. However, for those of us who know God, know that he's still in control of everything. And so our hearts and our minds will continually look to the hills from whence cometh our help. Our help comes from the Lord. I want to say this morning that we want to look at a word from God's word and try to use some practical application in our everyday walk of life. However, although the conversation everywhere you go and everything we do is talking about the coronavirus, and we know that that is there, but we know that God is still, as I said before, he's still in control of everything. And so we're trusting God to do what God does best. And that is that God will keep us, protect us, and see us through in times like this. I want to talk to us this morning from the subject that was read into our hearing from Luke chapter 7, 34 through 47. Loved, look beyond my faults. I want us to take a look at that. Love, look beyond my faults. We understand and know beyond the shadow of a doubt that God is love. And because he is love, he has a love unlike anyone else. But in this particular text, it is here that we discovered this chapter that John the Baptist is in prison and that he needs a confirmation that Jesus is the Messiah. However, Jesus assures John through his disciples that he is the Messiah by curing many of the infirmities and the plagues and evil spirits and giving sight to the blind. Jesus then sends John's disciples back unto him with the word to comfort and to encourage John and to let him know that there's no need to look for anybody else. I am he. I am it. I am the one that you spoke about. And after these things, Jesus, if you will, is invited to the house of one of the Pharisees to eat with him. And Jesus, as his custom, accepted the invitation graciously. And the Pharisees were a group of people. They were a separatist. However, them being a group of the separatists in the time of our Lord, they were the popular party, according to John 7 and 48. They were extremely, if you will, accurate and minute in all matters pertaining to the law and Moses, according to Matthew chapter 9 and verses number 14, Luke 11 and verses number 39. There was much that was sound in their creed. However, their system of religion was a form and nothing more than that, just a form. I came to share with you that there's a was a very lax morality. We first read it in the New Testament in Matthew 3 and around verse number 7. Jesus ranks them with the Sadducees as a generation of vipers. And whenever Jesus speaks, I believe that we all need to take heed and listen to what it is that Jesus has to say. These Pharisees were also noted for their self-righteousness and pride, according to Matthew 9 and 11, Luke 7 and 39. And Jesus, however, often rebuked the Pharisees from the beginning of his ministry. They showed themselves to be better and persistent enemies of Jesus. They fought against his teachings and they looked for any means or any way to destroy his influence among the people. Y'all know anybody like that today who's always looking for a way or an opportunity to knock you down? However, one of these Pharisees, Simon it was, invited Jesus to be his guest. I came by to tell you, it's good to have Jesus be a guest, but I don't want him to come and stay a little while. I want him to come and stay forever with me. However, we read here that Jesus accepted this Pharisee's invitation to eat with him there at his house. I'm here to tell you that it's a mighty good thing for everybody to invite Jesus to be a guest at their home. We need more Jesus in our homes. We need Jesus in our lives. We need Jesus not to be just a guest, but we need him to come and abide with us forever more. Perhaps if we did that, then we would have less crimes going on in the world. We would have less sinning going on in the world. We'd have more love in the world. We'd have more caring and compassion in the world. However, while Jesus was there at Simon's house of the city, there was a woman of the city who was a sinner. And she discovered that Jesus was at the Pharisee's house. She, the sinner woman, came unto the house where Jesus was. She brought something of a great value to Jesus. It was an alabaster box of ointment, a box of ointment and spikenard and precious, very precious. Those boxes were made from a stone found near alabaster in Egypt. But more importantly, I need you to understand, she brought her emotions. She brought her tears. She brought her heart and her love. She brought all of that with her. It was all contained within this one little sinner woman. Somebody ought to say amen. I need us to take the time just to take a look at her position that she was in. Her position, as we look at it and we see, first of all, she stood at his feet behind him. Number two, we need to see that her emotions caused her to weep. And then number three, we see her emptying herself. She was crying copious tears. We need to look at her love for Jesus as she wipes his feet with the hairs of her head. I came to tell you that she recognized the feet of Jesus and how beautiful the feet of Jesus were to her. We realize in Romans chapter 10 and 15, the Bible says how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. She recognized also his holiness, and I believe that all of us need to recognize the holiness of God, the holiness of his son, to realize and know that there's no one holier than he is. And we need that holiness not only in ourselves, but we need that holiness to permeate throughout this entire world wherein we live. She recognized his holiness and her unholiness. She saw her unholiness, but she saw his holiness. And however, we need to know that she needed the help, and she realized that in order for me to get the help that I need someone who has an unfailing love to see beyond all of my faults and to recognize my deep, deep down spiritual needs. I came to share with you, when we are in the presence of God,
We need to understand that all we value here on earth is not to be compared to the inheritance that God has for his children that is stored up for them here, there in heaven. Sometimes God, if you will, has to show us in life and reveal unto us ourselves in order for us to see him more clearly. I said, sometimes in life, God has to reveal us unto ourselves, because in our own eyes, we look like we are flawless. We look like we got it all together. But God has to reveal unto us ourselves oftentimes in order for us to see him. You can't see God looking at yourself. You can only see God when you look at God and compare yourself to him, not compare him to you. Somebody ought to say amen. See, in Isaiah, the Bible says in Isaiah 6, 1 and 5, the Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah said, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Then said I, woe is me, I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amidst a people of unclean lips. See, Isaiah didn't see himself until he saw God. When he saw God, he realized how pitiful and how messed up he was. In Isaiah 6, 1 through 5, we see that Isaiah saw the Lord. But not only did Isaiah see the Lord, I came by to tell you that the Lord also saw Isaiah. I'm here to tell you, we serve a God who sees everything. He even sees and knows our very thoughts that are far off. You can't fool God. You might fool man, but you can't fool God. God knows everything. You can run into the smallest little crack or the crevice of your house or this church building or anywhere else. I came by to tell you, God sees you when you went in there. God sees you moving around in there, and God will see you if he allows you to come out. My Bible tells me in Hebrews chapter 4 and around verses number 13 to confirm what I just said. The Bible said, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him whom we have to do. I don't know about y'all, but you might as well stop trying to hide and just come correct like this woman did. She said, listen, I'm coming out. I'm not hiding. I'm coming out. I need Jesus. Amen. We discover here in verse number 39 we see that Simon tried to investigate Jesus. You don't investigate Jesus. He made us. We didn't make him. In verse 39, the Bible says that the Pharisee that had bitten Jesus saw what the woman had done. And so he spoke within himself. I told you he sees everything. Jesus knows everything. He said, if this man was a prophet, he would have known who and what manner of woman this is that touched him, for she is a sinner. Don't that sound like somebody looking outside themselves or looking at somebody else? They all messed up, but I got it all together. However, when we began to see how the Bible unfolds this story, I'm here to tell you, that we need to be careful what you say to yourself. So you got to be careful what you say to yourself. He spoke within himself. He didn't think anybody knew what he was thinking or what he was thinking or holding in his heart, but the Lord knew. He spoke within himself. He spoke within himself. But I came by to tell you, the God that I serve knows and sees, as I said earlier, everything. Amen. I'm glad that he sees and he knows everything. I'm glad he sees further than I can see. He sees more than I see. He's able to reveal unto to me things that I haven't even seen about myself through his holy word. So when we began to look at this thing, we find out that he called her a sinner. But I'm here to tell you that we need to really be careful about how we see ourselves. Luke 12 and 17, Luke 16 and 3 and Mark 7 and 21 ought to help us to take a better inventory of how we see ourselves and be more concerned about how God sees us. See, I'm not concerned about how you see me so much. I'm more concerned about how God sees me. because it's going to matter in the end how God sees us. Some people are quick, if you will. I've learned in my short lifespan here that some people are quick to point out flaws in others, but they can never see the flaws in themselves. But God's son Jesus gave them a warning in the book of Matthew 7, 1 through 5. And we need to be thankful to God that he gives us the victory. In other words, we don't just go around judging folk based on what we see on our little limited imaginations and thoughts and information. We don't have enough to judge anybody on. We don't judge. We may see some fruit and inspect that, but we don't judge folk because we don't really understand that, guess what? We all are going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of the things that we've done in the body, whether they be good or evil. So be careful how you judge somebody else, because the same judgment you pass will be the same judgment you're met with. So we find out here, when Jesus is, I came to tell you, when Jesus is your judge, he looks at the acts and he examines the facts. Whenever Jesus is our judge, he looks at the acts and he examines the facts. And the fact is, based on biblical teaching, is that Romans 3:23, all have sinned and falling short of the glory of God. I've fallen. You've fallen. Your big mama's fallen. Your granddaddy's fallen. Everybody has fallen. You don't have to worry about anything because we all are on the same territory, the same ground level, the same motion picture. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what we've done. But when we began to think about this and really give some consideration, Simon didn't know that he had some flaws. He was flawed, but he didn't know it. He's like a lot of us today. We're flawed, but we don't think we're flawed. We look like we got it all together on the outside, but on the inside, we have flaws. And so what we try to do is that we try to cover up flaws. We know that women would do different things to cover up their flaws and whatnot. They will put eyelashes on. They will change their hair color. They will get the braids. They will get the wigs and all of that kind of stuff. The men these days are starting to get these fake lines around their head, get hair put in there. They'll turn around, get their mustache covered, get sideburns put in there, and you take a look at them sometime and whatnot, and you say, man, I thought you were all great. No, man, That really wasn't what was happening. But don't tell nobody. I got a little touch up. But we're always trying to change some stuff on the outside, but God is not really concerned about what we look like on the outside. He's concerned about our heart condition. See, Simon has some flaws. He just didn't know it. A lot of people got flaws and don't know it. They don't know it. But notice what happens here. Jesus lets him know that his heart condemned him. His intelligence misled him. His self-righteousness deceived him. He could see the woman's sin, but he couldn't see his own sin. Not only that, we have to learn how to guard our hearts and let the Lord lead you. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. We need to be having a spirit of humility and not a spirit of haughtiness. In other words, never think too highly of ourselves or too lowly of others, but let us think soberly and righteously as the Lord would have us to do so. We need to do that. Galatians chapter 6 and around verses number 7 tells us plainly, be not deceived. In other words, don't you fool yourself. Don't get tricked. Don't get bamboozled by the devil to thinking that you all that, because it's not so. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. But I came to tell you, while Simon was trying to investigate Jesus, Jesus examined Simon. I came to tell you that he examines all of us. He knows all of us. He knows our makeup because he created us in his very own image. And because he created us, who more knows more about you than the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father? Jesus examined Simon. Can I share this with y'all? Jesus said, listen to Jesus talk. Jesus said, Simon. Simon didn't know that he had been read. Jesus said, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. Two creditors, one on one a pence and the other 50. Simon, I need you to answer this for me. I know you're a smart man. I know you're an intelligent man. I know you're able to understand this. I need you to give me the answer because it's a teaching moment right here, right now. And I need to teach you something, Simon, that you didn't know before this woman came in, until this woman came in. But now when she came in, you still thought the same way about this woman. But I need to show you something that this woman has brought here to be a learning curve for you, to change your way of thinking and to teach you what I'm trying to get across to you. He said, Simon, listen, I have somewhat to say unto thee. Two creditors, one owing a pence and the other 50. They had nothing to pay with. Sounds like us. Am I right about it? We had nothing to pay with. We were broke, busted, and had nothing to pay with. We were spiritually bankrupt. We were hell bound. We were hell bound. We were sealed for hell. Nothing to pay our sin debt with. He said they had nothing to pay, but he frankly forgave them both were bankrupt. Psalms 3:32-1, the Bible said, blessed is the man whose transgressions are forgiven. Thank God for forgiving us our transgressions through his son, Jesus Christ. Jesus said, listen here, I need to share something with you. I need to let you know something that they were bankrupt. In other words, I need you to look at your portfolio and see that you're bankrupt also. Your stock has gone down. You are no longer in charge of what you think you're in charge of. You're broke. And you're standing in dire need of some fixing. So, Simon, let me put it to you gently. So what he does is he says, listen, Simon, I need you to know something. I need you to tell me, therefore, which of these men that were forgiven, the one with the one pence or the 50, you tell me, Simon, will love him the most? That's the question Jesus poses to Simon, the Pharisee. Simon said, the one that I suppose he forgave the most. Now, notice what he said. In other words, Simon, Jesus puts it back on without even raising the question. Simon, then I need to know something. Then how much do you owe? I raised the question to us this morning. How much do you owe? How deep is your debt? How much bankruptcy are you in? Not only that, are you willing and able to pay? But I need to know how much do you owe and how much are you able to pay? You can't pay anything. I came by to tell you, we can't pay anything for the debt that we owe the Lord God for what he has done for us. We had a debt we couldn't pay, but we had a Savior who paid it all. I'm glad this morning that Jesus paid it all. And because he paid it all, I'm able to cross over out of this earthly realm into the heavenly realm, being washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, called the Son of God, sealed by the Holy Spirit, have an inheritance, seated on the right hand of the Father is my big brother. And he gave me a seat in heaven since he's seated there. I'm glad this morning to be a child of God Almighty. I thank God every day for rescuing me who was not able to rescue himself. But not only that, Jesus said, thou hast rightly judged. So then he tells me, he said, I came to tell you, in other words, that things are not always as they appear. Amen. There's a lesson right there. I'm not going to stay there, but things are not always as they appear. In other words, just because you see something a certain way doesn't mean that it is what it is. And just because you see something a certain way does not mean that it's going to stay as it is. I came by to drop this in your spirit if you allow me to do this here. Things look bad for the world right here, right now. But for those of us who are children of the Most High God, things don't look bad at all because we've turned to the back of the book and we already know how the story's going to end. We already know that glory is ours. And we know that God has already blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We already know what's going to happen. We know we have a reward. We know that this is not it. As a matter of fact, our hope is not in the things of this world. Our hope is in Christ Jesus. And when you have a hope in Christ Jesus, you're not focused on all these things that are down here and that are going on. Yes, we know that we're in turmoil. Yes, we know that there is a crisis. But I'm glad to know that I serve a Christ who's bigger than my crisis. He's able to outlive all of my disasters. take care of me when my dilemmas are, then set me on a solid rock and allow me to know that I can lay down and sleep at night and know that if morning comes and the Lord allows it, when I get up, I can get up with joy and thanksgiving, saying, Father, thank you for one more day. You kept me here for a purpose. I don't know exactly what it is, but I know one of them, and that is to praise and glorify your high and holy name. When God has been good to you and has blessed you and has looked past all your flaws and has taken care and healed your open wounds and has allowed you to be put on display for the world to see that this is not somebody that you drive off in. This is here in the showcase for everybody else to see. We're on display for the world. For the world to see and the world to know that we belong to the Almighty God. And I thank God for that. I thank God for that. So we need to know that, guess what? We need to be careful and not be judging other people according to 2 Corinthians 5 and 10. Amen. Judge not, if we're going to judge, not according to appearance. But we need to judge righteous judgment. John 7 and 24, I heard Jesus say that. Jesus turned to the woman and then he said to Simon, he said, take a good look. In other words, Simon, I want you to take a look at this woman. I want you to take a look while she's here amidst the two of us and others. Right. Take a good look at this woman that you look down on. Okay. Oftentimes, I don't know about you all, but I've had folk to look down because I didn't meet their so-called standard. All right. However, that was their own ideology and their own thought. I always knew I was somebody, and I really knew I was somebody when I became a child of God. And so it doesn't matter how man looks down. What matters is how we look up. Right. See, we're not looking up to man for anything. We're not looking up to man to end this epidemic right here, this pandemic. We're looking up to God to take care of the situation. Amen. Oh, yeah. I like this right here. So we understand and know that Jesus turned to the woman and he said to Simon, he said, take a look. Okay. Simon, you look at this woman that you look down on. Show yourself. Let me give you some scriptural examples here, if you will, that how God can let us see ourselves and how he gave Simon some examinations to take a look at his own MRI. God, son Jesus, takes the MRI and then he puts it and presents it like any good doctor would do before the patient to let the patient see exactly what he's trying to explain to him. Jesus comes to him and he tells him, he says, Simon, listen. I want you to examine this MRI right here because it was taken of you. You're comparing yours with this woman right here. We know she's got some issues because I know everything. But yet you want to judge her and then you want to judge me. But I came here to let you know that I took an examination of you, Simon. And what I discovered in the examination is that you invited me to your house to be your guest. And even though I'm your guest, we understand and know that there's certain things that follow when you have a guest to your house. First of all, you gave me no water for my feet. But you want to compare yourself to this woman about her being a sinner, but she washed my feet with her tears. Not only did she wash my feet with her tears, she wiped them with the hairs of her head. We know that we find in Genesis 18 and 4 that it was customary to wash guests' feet. John 13, 3 and 5. Jesus even washed the disciples' feet. But not only that, you gave me no kiss. And I came to your house, a guest at your house. You overlooked the kiss that I should have received that is customary to one that's welcome. Exodus 18 and 7. But this woman never stopped kissing my feet. 2 Samuel 15 and 5, Romans 16 and 16. This woman anointed my head with oil, but you didn't anoint anything on me, according to Psalms 104 and verses number 15. You should have done it, but you didn't do it. This woman anointed my feet with an ointment, Jesus said. In other words, here, he said, let me tell you something here. Her sins are many, but they are forgiven. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Take a look at Isaiah 1 and 18, if you will, when you get a chance, in Isaiah 55 and 7. In other words, Jesus is saying, Simon, you got it all twisted. Is that all right with y'all? You invited me to your house to be your guest, but you showed me no real welcome. You never showed me the real hospitality that I was supposed to receive, but yet you looking down on this particular woman. I stop by to tell you, be careful how you look down on someone unless you're looking down to help that person up and allow them to see Jesus in you or lead them to Jesus. See, I need us to understand that when we look at this thing here, they're for wrong motives, if you will.
Okay.
We'll promote misjudgment.
Oh, yes, sir.
See, when you got wrong motives, they promote misjudgment.
Amen.
See, Simon invited Jesus, and you know, he invites him there, but he's looking at it, he would, if he really knew who this woman was, he wouldn't have her here. He's not really a prophet. Now, when you got wrong motives, you'll have misjudgment. But not only that, as we prepare our hearts and minds to close out this morning, see, Simon's problem was he was comparing himself by himself. Don't ever get stuck in comparing yourself by yourself, and don't compare yourself with somebody else that walks around here with two legs, two arms, a nose, eyes, and a mouth, just like you. We are not to compare ourselves with one another because we all jacked up. Yeah, we all jacked up, and we all need God's divine grace and mercy. And so that was his problem. And too many people in the world are in need of what the sinner woman received. They're in the need of what the sinner woman received from Jesus. But see, they see themselves as Simon saw himself. See, you can have a need and not recognize your need because everything is going your way. But your need is still there. You just haven't recognized your need. But when your need comes to fruition, and it allows you to see that what you really need is not to look down on someone. What you really need is not to be judging someone. What you really need is the Lord to help you become a child of God. What you really need is the Spirit of God. What you really need is the love of God. What you really need is the compassion of God. What you really need is to express the fact that I too am a sinner standing in need of a Savior who can deliver me from the disgusting place where I've been all my life and where I take me to where I need to go throughout eternity. That's what you really need.
Right.
I heard Paul, if you will. I was listening in, and I heard Paul say this. Paul said in 1 Timothy 1:15-16, he said, this is, Paul, tell us what it is. Paul said, this is a faithful saying. Okay, it's a faithful saying, but how worthy of it is it, Paul? Paul said, worthy of all acceptation.
All
right. What does that mean? He said that Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul looked at himself, and when he looked at himself and he saw Jesus on the Damascus Road, he realized that, guess what? I'm a sinner. I needed Jesus to come into the world to save sinners because I'm a chief sinner. Paul ranked himself ahead of all other sinners, but I came by to tell you that all of us are sin. There's no little sin, no big sin. All sin is sin, and so we need to understand, no, well, I ain't as bad as so-and-so. Yeah, you are as bad as so-and-so. You're just judging yourself by somebody else. But according to the word of God, all of us are sinners, and there's no difference between our sins.
Amen.
But I'm mindful of what God did, even though we are sinners.
Okay.
The Bible says, but God.
All right.
What did God do? But God so loved the world.
Amen.
That God gave his only begotten son. That whosoever believeth on him would not perish but have life everlasting.
Yeah.
John 3:16, Romans 5:8. But God,
right.
But God commended his love toward us while and yet we were still sinners. God, if you will, when we look at him, Jesus tells us, according to Matthew 20:37-39, Jesus told them then, he tells us the same thing now.
Okay.
Jesus said unto them, notice what he says. And this is for you and I. He said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart.
Right.
God does not want half-hearted people.
Amen.
With a half-hearted love.
Amen.
He said, with all thy heart, with all thy soul,
right.
With all thy mind. And then he told him, he said, back then when he was writing to him, he said, this is the first and the great commandment. And the second is like unto it. What is it? I remember an old man telling me some years ago, he said they were twins.
Okay.
He said these two, this scripture had some twins in it. He said, and the second is like unto that thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Well, when we understand that God doesn't want half of anything, but he wants all of us, we need to strive to give him no less than all of us. Amen. Because half is unacceptable. Amen. I don't want half of a paycheck when I was working. Amen. I don't want half of a wife. Well. I don't want half of a friend. Right. I don't want half of a car. Right. I don't want half of good health. I want it all. That's what I want. I want it all. And so we ought to be able to understand that when the Lord says with all, he wants it all. But look here, how deep is your love for Jesus? Okay. How deep is it? That's the question on the floor. Okay. And I'm closing. Do you love him enough to do just as this sinner woman did and come to him? Do you love him enough to say, Lord, I'm coming to you. I'm about to end my old, reckless, ruined life. I'm coming and I'm going to put myself at your feet. I'm laying myself at your feet. All right. Do you love him enough to do that? Because he's shown us how much he loved us. Amen. When we were unlovable, he loved us. He did it first. We love him because he first loved us. He didn't ask us to do anything that he didn't do. Do you love him enough to believe his gospel? What is the gospel? That Jesus came, he hung, bled, and died, and was buried in a borrowed tomb, and he rose the third day. Yes, they crucified him. Yes, they buried him. But yet he got up. He shed his royal red blood that you and I might be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Do you love him enough to believe his gospel? Do you love him enough to accept him as your Lord and your Savior today? Right. Why would you wait until tomorrow when you can have a Savior today? Amen. You can get your vaccine today. Right. Do you love him enough to forsake your old way of life? Do you love him? He loves you enough to die out on Calvary's cross. Right. He loved me enough to shed his royal red blood. He loved me enough to call me by the gospel out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. Do you love him enough to confess him and be baptized today into Christ Jesus? Well. Or are you like Simon? You see yourself as a doubter of his godship. If he was really God, he would know that I'm not in need of God's help. But what God's seen is that all of us stood in need of God's help. Finally, if you will, let me tell you something about this love that looked past all of my flaws. Okay, 1 John chapter 4, 8 through 11. He that loves who loves not knows not God. For God is love. Amen. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love. Not that we beloved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Right. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. I came by to tell you, if you really want to manifest the love of God, start loving one another so that people can see and heaven can see that you've really been touched by the love of God. Look beyond some people's flaws and tell them that I know somebody that can make you flawless. You ain't got to leave them where you found them, but at least you can help them and share the good news of the gospel that, guess what, I know somebody who's able to look beyond your flaws and take you to a place where your flaws are covered up in the match name of Jesus by his blood. I know somebody that can save you. I know somebody that can rescue you from yourself. Do like the woman, fall at his feet and start crying over your sins. Look at him as a Savior. Look at him as Lord. Look at him as a captain of your salvation. Look at him as your Redeemer. Look at him as the Lamb of God. Look at him as God Almighty. Jesus, the Alpha and the Omega. Look at him and see him in your life. You being more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Amen. I urge us as with this last part here that if you are looking down on someone, let it be that you may be lifting them up to see Jesus. All right. That he might give them the salvation that is needed. Right. He purposed for them before the foundation of the world. How deep is your love? Is it deep enough to share the good news of the gospel in these trying times? Right. Is it deep enough for you to say, listen, Lord, hear my, send me like Isaiah. All right.
Is it deep enough to look beyond what someone has done to you and look to Jesus and realize and know that we've done more than anyone could ever begin to give an account of to him, yet he still loves us. He's ready, willing, and able to forgive us of all of our sins. We need to understand that in order to become a child of God, we have to accept this gospel. We have to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He died for our sins. He was buried in a borrowed tomb, and he rose the third day. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We need to hear the word of God, and then we need to believe that. We need to believe that with all of our hearts. For he that come to God must believe that he is. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek after him. We need to repent. Let's turn from our ways unto the ways of God. The Bible tells us, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. At one time, God winked at the ignorance of men, but now he has commanded all men everywhere to repent. We need to confess Christ to be the Son of the living God. Matthew tells us that he that confess me before men, him also will I confess before my Father, which is in heaven. We need to do that. Then we need to be buried with him in the watery grave of baptism for the remission of sin, according to Mark 16 and 15. We need to do that. We need to do that. And the Lord saves us. The Lord adds us to his church, according to Acts 2 and 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people, the Lord added to the church daily, such as should be saved. There we have God looking over us. There we have God who has blessed us. There we have God who has washed us. And then we have God, if you will, who makes us a new creature. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17, if any man, woman, boy, girl be in Christ, not that he might be, not that he should be, not that he will be, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. Behold, old things are passed away and everything has become new. You can have a new outlook on life. You can have a new love that you've never found before. You can have a new peace that can only be found in Christ Jesus. You can have a new blood transfusion that will cleanse you from all unrighteousness when you slip and fall. You can have a family and a relationship with God of your own that in hard times, he's able to make them great times. How do you take hard times and make them great times? You take hard times and make them great times by knowing that the one who owns you owns everything. And that because he owns everything and he owns you, you have access to everything that he owns because you belong to him. God is your Abba. He's your daddy. And Jesus is your big brother. And the Holy Spirit is your guide. What a comforting thought to know that God has given that to all of us who will trust and obey him. The invitation is yours. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed?
That's a great question.
It's
a great question. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
And are you fully trusting in his grace?
In his grace, God's gift.
Are you washed?
Are you trusting
in the blood?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Oh, are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood? In the blood? In the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb, and all your garments.
The offering. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning at the 6th verse, and it reads, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according to his he's purposed in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. And finally in verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Let us give thanks. Most gracious and loving Father, we approach your mighty throne of grace, thanking you, Father, for being able just to call upon your high and exalted name. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask as we prepare our hearts and minds to give back unto you, dear Heavenly Father, recognizing, dear Heavenly Father, that you gave the greatest gift of all, and that was your Son, Jesus Christ, Father. Help us to do as we was read, dear Heavenly Father, not grudgingly or necessity, Father, but of a cheerful spirit, dear Heavenly Father. This prayer we truly ask in your Son, Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm a hard-fighting soldier, and I'm on the battlefield. I'm a hard-fighting soldier, and I'm on the battlefield. And I'm a hard-fighting soldier, and I'm on the battlefield. I keep on bringing souls to Jesus by the service that I give. Man.
At this time, brothers and sisters, we're getting ready for our communion. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 30, and it reads, "For I receive of the Lord that also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament of my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink in remembrance of me. For as oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak, and many are sickly among you, and many are asleep. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the sacrifice that you made by giving your darling Son, Jesus Christ, for us, for we may have the right for the tree of life. We pray for the one that take up his broken body, and of the shed blood, that they take it with a clean heart and a pure mind. Father, this is our prayer. We ask in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So let us take off his broken body and off his shed blood.
Come to you, Father God, humble as we know how, Father, thanking you for all your goodness, your grace, and your mercy, Father God.
Yes.
Thank you for keeping us safe when this world is at turmoil, Father God.
Yes.
Father God, you allow us to sleep and rest and slumber in the bed without worry, Father God.
Yes.
Continue to watch over us and keep us, Father God.
Yes.
And Father God, we know we're going to trust you no matter what, Father God.
Yes.
We don't keep calling on you no matter what, Father God.
Yes.
And Father God, we're going to keep praising you no matter what, Father
yes.
God. And Father God, as we leave this place, Father God, we're praying that you watch over and keep us, Father God.
Yes.
Bless this world, Father God. Touch those who are fearful right now, Father
yes.
God. And Father God, let them to know you, Father God, to remove
yes.
that fear, the ultimate
yes.
God in charge
yes.
of all things,
yes.
despite what our eyes might see, Father
yes.
God. So thank you, Father God. We ask this prayer in your Son, Jesus Christ's name, Father God, until we come again to praise you and worship you, Father God.
Yes.
Keep us and watch over us, Father God. We ask this prayer in your Son, Jesus Christ's name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Jesus.